happiness when we are alone and free. Normally what happens, we think of things, what tensions I have. When we are free, we think of more and more. When we are busy, in office world, we don't have time to think it. When we are alone and free, we think of tensions only. So how to get happiness when we are alone and free?
Very good. Number one. One of things that we should have is keep learning. Meaning that having company of good books which are inspiring, or so, some literature, some talk, something which is inspiring where we learn, so that also makes us happy even when we are alone. So, getting some intellectual joy, number one. Also, tap into your creativity and see if you can find out ways in what you are doing in your office and in your day-to-day life. Give a thought to how can I make it more effective? Find ways I can become a bigger contributor, or how can I make all my actions as acts of contribution? Find out ways of doing, when you are alone, you can direct your mind into this kind of things. So that also will tap into your own creativity, and you'll find satisfaction of having used your time well in a creative manner. So if you enjoy music, if you enjoy reading something, but learning is the best way, an attitude of learning more and more. Not only learning about your profession, of course, learning about life and learning about being a more enlightened person, a better person, more creative person, more greater contributor.
Namaste Swamiji. Actually, one question. You spoke about the win-win situation, right? So, but when we are into sports, right, at national level or international level, how is that possible? Because there has to be someone who has to lose. Even in Mahabharata, right? So it's not possible in these scenarios where you have to create a win-win situation. So how do you deal with this particular aspect where you are competitive and you want to win for probably for your country or for your organization or whatever it may be?
Good, that's a good question. Now the thing is, it's an unfortunate situation that now we have created, that you play to win rather than enjoying the play. If you enjoyed the playing also, the basic rule is that, see, there is action, there is effort, and there is output. So usually we have postponed our happiness or joy towards output. It's the result that makes us happy or unhappy. In the process, the effort just goes without yielding any kind of a profit. But if you enjoy that very effort, if you enjoy the play, of course there will be somebody who will win, but then if you enjoy that play, then win or loss will not be as important as it is now. And another thing is, it is not just a loss that makes us unhappy. It is the way I judge myself when I lose. Failure need not necessarily make us unhappy. What makes us unhappy is my judgment that I failed, you know. So when the failure is connected to I, that is when I become unhappy. When success connected to I, then I become happy. That's getting happiness from something else. But enjoying the very play. You may certainly play to win, all right, but the play itself is a source of enjoyment. Then the outcome doesn't remain very important. And therefore, and more important is, how do you judge yourself? That it is not you who have failed. That failure is a part of life. So that way it's a win-win situation as far as you are concerned. That you win, if you win, and you win even if you lose, because you enjoyed it anyway. So wind is meant for enjoying our happiness, which we get anyway.
Swamiji, you have beautifully unearthed the treasure that is hidden within each one of us.
Mm-hmm.
I would like to ask a question that in this sedentary lifestyle nowadays we have and a very busy schedule. So what kind of strategies we can adopt on a day-to-day basis so that we can find out the treasure which is hidden within us? Is it self-talk or any other strategy that you can suggest to all of us?
Very good. Let us say that we set aside, say 15 minutes during the morning before we start our work day and review the possible events that will take place during the day and look at that event and ask yourself, how can I make that event or interaction? Can I make it an event of, can I in some way contribute to that event? So tapping into yourself is by being a contributor, is by being a giver. As I said, giver of yourself, whatever you have, your talent you have, your emotions you have, your kindness you have, your intelligence you have, your knowledge you have. So what is going to happen during the day is some important events. How can I make them the opportunities? Apart from doing what I need to do, over and above that, how can I make them opportunities to contribute something that I have? That's a strategy. Now, you may not remember it when the time comes. It is possible because there's a lot of excitement. Doesn't matter. In the evening, again, spend another 15 minutes and see how your strategy worked. But if you make this a practice, then you'll remember when the time comes, hey, wait, I'm supposed to do it this way. This will be the attitude. So if you planned and rehearsed in the morning, it's likely that on some occasions I will remember and you'll be able to put that into practice. It can happen more and more, and ultimately whatever we do, we will find ways, innovative ways of being contributor through what we do. Because contribution was an attitude which directs the way I do things. And so you do what you need to do, but the way you do that can make all the difference. If kindness is perceived as weakness, number one, we should look at ourselves as what makes me express my kindness. Is it out of some weakness that I am doing, out of some helplessness that I am doing, or is it from freedom that I am doing? So kindness goes with freedom. And when I'm doing it with freedom, I do not think that it will be perceived as weakness. But then, you may be right also, that sometimes our intentions are not quite recognized by people and they may be misinterpreted. Then maybe you need to change the way of how you come across. So kindness and how you come across to other people so that you are not perceived as a weak person. Because kindness does not come from weakness, it always comes from strength. Kindness always comes from strength. Because you have a choice of not being kind, and you are being kind. So it's not very likely that you are perceived as a weak person. If you are, then you look at yourself and see if you can bring about a change in yourself in expressing your kindness so that you know people don't perceive you that way.
Yes.
these output are like unpredictable. So if it is satisfied, then we are happy. If it is not satisfied, then we are unhappy. So what I feel is the main source of unhappiness is we are doing some action driven by some internet output. So how can a person try to change this attitude?
Right. So when you perform an action, naturally the output is the motivating point. I do something for achieving some end. There's all the purpose behind performing an action. And that's quite fair. That when we do something, there is a purpose behind it. There is a certain goal, there's no question about it. The point is, what is my relationship with the outcome? The outcome has to be there, and I wish that it means, you know, we always work for success. Nobody wants to work for failure. When I shoot an arrow, I want to hit the target. Similarly, whatever action you perform is for an outcome. And a successful outcome also. The question is not outcome. That we perform actions for the purpose of outcome is not a problem. It is what is my relationship with the outcome. Do I postpone my happiness for outcome or do I also enjoy my effort? The effort and outcome. What happens is, sometimes outcome is given out of proportion importance and effort loses this importance. Understand that effort also is as important, if not more, than outcome. So our attitude and approach is, how can I also enjoy my effort? See, there is no uncertainty there. In outcome, there is uncertainty because we do not know whether we will have a favorable outcome or not. As far as effort is concerned, it is in my hand. And when that effort is an attitude of being a contributor, you surely enjoy it. If your effort is out of a sense of being useful, being a contributor, out of kindness, out of values, you will enjoy that effort. So when you enjoy the effort, then the enjoyment coming outcome will not have that much greater impact on you, because effort is what is under your control. If you enjoy the effort, it's a certain happiness, not uncertain. There is no uncertainty in that happiness. That's why he said kindness. Contributor is an attitude during the effort which you can enjoy doing what you are doing. So our approach or strategy is, how can I enjoy what I am doing? And it's a matter of our decision, choice. I want to enjoy this. But Swami, is a tedious word. It's a manatana swayana. It's again our conclusion. That a given verse is tedious, something is monotonous, something is repetitive. How can I enjoy? Why can't you enjoy? Every day you sleep is repetitive, still you enjoy it. You know, it's not that you can't enjoy something that you do every day. Every day you eat and still you enjoy it. There's no, it's just a conclusion that I can't enjoy the same thing. You can. It need not be the same thing. You can always bring in some little, you know, innovation in what you're doing. And the same thing also, something you can do, something different. You can decorate something, you can make it innovative, ornament some, you know, make your work ornamented. So again, it's a matter of my decision that I want to enjoy what I do. People say it's a monotonous, so how can you enjoy? That is their problem. But something, yeah, all I have to do is this, you know. Put here or there. How can you enjoy that? You can enjoy that. See, this has come here. I put it there. How nice it looks here. Looks nice there also. Or something like that. You know, after all, use your creativity, innovation in making it interesting. After all, either something makes it interesting to you or you make it interesting yourself. So there's freedom in one thing and depends on another thing, you know. So use your creative strategy in making interesting what you do and enjoy what you do. Of course, work for an outcome. And you want a successful outcome, we won't deny that, because the world judges over an outcome. Let them judge. And so you have to try to get your outcome also. But you don't postpone your satisfaction or outcome. You gain satisfaction from what your effort also. In that case, it is in your control. There is no uncertainty there. Outcome is uncertain. Do I make sense? Okay. Here. Oh, there.
So you spoke about like success and then related to attitude and then happiness. So in reality also you spoke about like restricted resources and people who have access to it and who don't have access to it. So how do you relate a powerful and a powerless in the same happiness? So like, can you relate a beggar and a guy with a BMW with the same level of happiness, or how do you kind of compare the happiness?
So is it possible that a beggar who has nothing can be as happy as a person who has BMW? Is it possible? Theoretically it's possible. Depends on the attitude that each one has. It's the attitude that makes us happy. Attitude and the physicalization of that attitude. Put that attitude into practice. So beggar also can have an attitude of being a kind person. That he gets some chapati, he shares half of it with somebody, that can make him happy. Beggar also are vying for a place on the sidewalk, the footpath, you can, you know, allow somebody to share a part of it. It's a matter of attitude, that you don't allow anybody around you, you don't, you know, or you have the attitude of sharing whatever you have. As I said, kindness everybody has. He may not have much of bread, he may not have much of resources to share, but if he has the attitude of kindness, he'll find some ways of creating comfort or contributing to somebody. It may be a small thing. A big person may do big thing. A small person may do small things. But it's the attitude. Meaning that even if you don't have anything outwardly, you can still be a happy person. If you have that right attitude, then you put that attitude into practice. Fortunately, happiness doesn't require any resources. All that it requires is you. Unfortunately, unhappiness also doesn't require anybody than you. Meaning that I am enough to create happiness for myself, I am enough to create unhappiness for myself. I am the source of both. So it's up to me whether to make myself happy or unhappy. I cannot blame anybody else to make me unhappy. Swamiji, my boss is like this, my client is like this, fellow is like that. They are what they are. It's up to me as to how to relate. So understand that I am the one who makes myself happy and I am the one who makes myself unhappy. With the right attitude, nobody can make me unhappy. With the wrong attitude, nobody can make me happy. This is for me. Yes, sir.
There are these concepts of Bhogananda, Bhavananda, and beyond that is Atmananda. How can one tap into Atmananda? Initially you alluded to Bhogananda, and we have talked a lot about Bhavananda. How to go to the next stage of Atmananda? The question makes sense.
Yes, 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 sure. The answer is there is only one Ananda, that is Atman is the only Ananda. Now he is technically technical question. Bhogananda means the happiness coming from the objects of pleasure. That's Bhogananda. That's called Bhoga. Second is, as we say, the happiness that comes from being kind and compassionate. He calls it Bhavananda. Then happiness coming from self, he calls Atmananda. Happiness is only one. It seems to come from different sources, but the only source is yourself. So really speaking, even when you are enjoying a pizza, you are enjoying yourself through that. When enjoying your kindness, again you are enjoying. And this leads ultimately to, what is Atmanand is that you are happy without any reason, without any effort. So right now I have to make an effort to be kind, because still not become my nature, be just a kind person. When I become just spontaneously kind, by practicing this kindness, in course of time you become spontaneously kind. That's Atmananda. When you become spontaneously good, spontaneously kind, spontaneously contributor, then you tapped effortlessly the happiness that is you, that is Atmananda. I'm sure you expected a different answer of some meditation and stuff like that, but this, we are giving you simple answers, you know. The spontaneity is what is we are seeking. Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namah Hari Om.